the island of Mallorca in Spain. Crime here tends to be rather mundane. Tourists lose travelers' checks. There are fights in discos. Foreigners who live on the island incline mostly to quiet respectability. But there was one foreigner living here who police found tantalizing. Interpol had asked them to tap his phone.
Hello, Brando?
Yeah,
how are you?
Thank you.
The calls usually were in code.
I tell you why, because I think your dog is sick.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think so. He had to report he's got a new complaint.
Oh, yeah?
And it would appear that, I don't know...
Craig Lovato of the Drug Enforcement Administration tried to decipher them.
I was frightened. I mean, quite literally listening to these voices and listening to what they were discussing was like listening to the heart of organized crime.
At daybreak or earlier, the calls would begin.
He was calling Manila, he was calling Bangkok, he was calling Hong Kong, Zurich, the United States.
He's only asking for money.
The voice began to obsess Lovato. It exuded infuriating charm. It was persuasive and civilized.
You knew from the outset that this was a man with an intellect.
Certainly did.
The voice belonged to Dennis Howard Marks. As the DEA computer revealed, Marks was the stuff of legend, eluding police for years, claiming mysterious connections with intelligence agencies. This investigation would lead Lovato into an altogether alien world. Oxford University, Britain in the 60s. In 1964, a boy from Wales arrived at Balliol College, Oxford. In time, he'd rent a cottage outside the city. He was attractive and charming.
He fitted into Balliol, which was a very intellectual college, very well. He was a very clever guy.
He was very nice, and he was very Welsh, and he was very sort of country, provincial boy.
Exudes charm in the nicest possible way. He could charm his way out of anything.
He was very considerate and very romantic and lovely.
He's never wanted to conceal his own myth, and his own myth is very important to him.
For Howard Marks, Oxford was a privileged place to be.
It's predominantly a place of privilege, yes. But exceptions were allowed, you know, the odd kind of peasant from the valleys was accepted in, and I was lucky enough to be there.
Marx chose an image, that of working class hero, went down very well at Oxford.
Nobody was from the same socioeconomic. I mean, we know, the Welsh miners' sons at Oxford were not sick on the ground in those days.
In reality, Howard Marx wasn't a miner's son. His background was modest but comfortable. All the same, he conjured up images of poor mining towns, children stained with coal dust.
You know, I mean, I might say, and did you have coal in the bath and walk barefoot to school? And he would say, yes, yes, yes. And then probably would go and tell somebody else that he kept coal in the bath and walked barefoot to school. You know, I mean, that was part of his image, you know, that he was this illiterate Welsh miner's son.
At Oxford, Marx became a star. He acquired a retinue of loyal fans.
But it was just that it was hard to see him on his own, except in bed.
To understand what Oxford was like at that period of time, mid-60s, late-60s, Palmer is absolutely the heart of the thing. Howard personified that thing. We were the generation that had discovered sex, as we thought. Very loose controls of an academic sort, all the sort of old morals and things were collapsing around us. It was a wonderful time, and we felt we were right at the center of it.
In the 40s and 50s, marijuana had been seen as an evil. It was supposed to drive you crazy. Now, at Oxford, it was everywhere.
A lot of pot was being smoked around Oxford at the time, or certainly at any party. And I just knew Howard as, you know, somebody else who smoked pot.
The old fear of marijuana had gone. Howard Marks needed no encouragement. He plunged headlong into the drug culture.
Cannabis. Konapina. Kanamaza. Kana.
When I first smoked marijuana, it was a noticeable experience, but terribly mild. I remember giggling rather more than normally and finding things amusing and finding time slowing down.
Oneb, hinab, hinni, hemp, hanab. Cannabis indica, cannabis sativa.
To anyone who'd listen, Marx advocated the legalization of cannabis. At his cottage outside Oxford, he pursued a blurred but blissful ideal of country life.
So I went out there on the Friday evening with the lady I was then living with for dinner, and eventually got back home into town to discover that it wasn't, as I thought, Saturday morning. It was Tuesday morning.
Mixing business with pleasure, Marx dispensed marijuana and the occasional sugar cube laced with LSD, for which he'd make a modest charge.
I think it was about £3 in those days.
A post-mortem has been held on Brian Jones, the 27-year-old member of the Rolling Stones who died early.
The drugs were beginning to kill.
Inquest will probably be held.
Even at Oxford, Joshua Macmillan, grandson of the British Prime Minister, overdosed on heroin.
My memory is really just of Joshua Macmillan's body being carried down the stairs. It is a very shocking experience. I'd always been frightened of heroin before that, and that kind of sealed the issue as far as I was concerned.
These were times of startling political and social change. Howard Marks relished every moment. He thought of being a professor at Oxford and actually delivered a lecture.
It went down very well.
Really?
Yes. It was on the differences between Leibniz and Newton's views on space and time.
Were you surprised that it went down so well?
Astonished, yes.
What was Howard going to do with his life? He was very clever, but he hated the straight line. Given where he was, what sort of person he was, and his great need for fun, gratification, the money that sort of oiled the wheels of fun. I guess crime was the obvious thing, really. But the drugs thing was just made for Howard, I guess.
Come with us, please, friend. We've got a search warrant, I'll show it to you.
All over London, hippies were being busted.
Somebody stand at the door, nobody goes out.
Howard Marks hoped he was too smart to be caught. Yeah. Cops seemed boring. Dope dealers were glamorous and clever.
Travelling a lot and having been to all these exciting places and evading customs officers and thinking of schemes to evade them, I found this glamorous and exciting.